HarperCollins presents The Theory of Everything Else, A Voyage into the World of the Weird. Written and read by Dan Schreiber, including an exclusive conversation between me and my guests, Jamie Morton of My Dad Wrote a Porno, Ella Al-Shamahi, TV presenter and paleoanthropologist, and Craig Glenday, the editor-in-chief of the Guinness World Records. This book opens with a quote. What if a chicken is an egg's way of making more eggs? Anonymous. For Finella, Wilf, Ted, and Littlest Foot, my four favorite weirdos. Ford, the rough corner. There is a concept practiced by Zen gardeners called the rough corner. The idea being that somewhere in every beautifully tended garden, there should remain a patch of land left completely untouched, growing wild and chaotic, so as to remind the gardener of how the universe intended it to look. I believe we should all be cultivating a healthy rough corner in our minds, a small nook at the back of the brain that ensures we never fail to get goosebumps when we're told a mad as hell idea, no matter how batshit it may be. It's important to keep this rough corner ragged and free to grow as nature intended, because great things have been achieved by those who believe in weird ideas. Disclaimer, a warning. The author of this work does not accept responsibility for any overgrown rough corners the listener might end up cultivating as a result of listening to this book. All the theories in this book want you to believe in them. Don't even think of it. Read up on them? Yes. Discuss them with your friends? Definitely. Sit back and let the ideas alter your universe for just a few seconds? Absolutely. But for God's sake, don't believe in a single one of them. However, I know it's not up to me what you'll make of all of these theories, no matter how much I warn you against them. Any idea you connect with that helps make sense of your place in this universe can develop into an unstoppable force. To some extent, all of these theories are alive. At least, that's certainly the impression they give. They've been translated into multiple languages and are at this very moment being discussed at breakfast tables and dinner parties around the world. They crop up in innumerable school classrooms, are debated by the finest minds in the world's leading universities, and have become the all-consuming obsession of amateur sleuths. They have their own websites, social media accounts, and Netflix specials. One has even done so well that it has its very own soundtrack, written and performed by Stevie Wonder. They're all incredibly successful at being talked about and will do their absolute best to make you think that they're true. But please remember, this isn't a book of facts. It is a book of facts in inverted commas. None of the theories in this book are true. Well, not yet, anyway. They're just ideas, speculations, beliefs, and claims begging to be accepted as truths. So, should you walk away at the end of this book believing that the only reason we became the dominant species on this planet is because predators found us too smelly to eat? Or that the living descendants of Christ are a family of garlic farmers living in Japan? Or that office plants should be employed as police detectives? Well, that's on you. Introduction. Hello from the odder side. In 1956, archaeologist George Mikanowski was plodding his way through a remote region of the Bolivian bush when he stumbled upon a group of locals partaking in a festival of dance, drink, and general debauchery, code word, orgies. After making some inquiries, Mikanowski learnt that this was an annual event, and that every year, for thousands of years now, whole communities from hundreds of miles away would gather together to celebrate. Celebrate what? Asked the archaeologist. Can't remember, replied the Bolivians. Somewhere along the line, they'd all forgotten why they were actually doing this. However, not ones to let a minor administrative error like this get in their way. They continued to meet up once a year to make sure to commemorate whatever it is they were supposed to be commemorating. I first spotted this anthropological puzzle a few years back while flipping through a 1973 edition of Time magazine as I browsed a secondhand bookshop in London. It's a story I've thought a lot about since. Though it may sound trivial, for me the mystery of the dancing Bolivians perfectly illustrates something that's at the very heart of this book, which is that no matter where you look in this world, you can guarantee that something bizarre, improbable, and unexplained is going on. And more importantly, no matter how small that mystery may seem, there's most likely someone or something out there dedicating their time to solving it. Right now, as you listen to these words, there are scientists in Silicon Valley who are spending their days trying to work out if the universe is actually just a giant video game. There are ornithologists in Australia who are attempting to prove their theory that there's a species of bird singing pop songs from the 1920s in the wild. And in Poland, there's a ghost hunter who continues to warn us of his belief that ghosts have become so annoyed by the recent rise of skepticism about their existence that they're threatening to go on strike. If you're going to have that attitude, we're not going to bother haunting you anymore, appears to be the message. Everyone, it seems, has a theory they're trying to prove, be it about something as big as the meaning of life or as small as trying to work out why Australians speak the way they do. No one's quite sure how the Australian accent developed. One theory has it that due to Australia's vast fly population, Aussies were forced to talk with their teeth gritted, otherwise they might end up with a mouthful of insects. Sorry for the accent. There's just so much we don't know. Why are we here? Do ghosts exist? Are we being visited by extraterrestrials? Are plants sentient? And why, when you're in the shower, does the shower curtain always billow in towards you? Interestingly, as it stands, there are four competing theories, the most recent of which comes from the scientist David Schmidt of the University of Massachusetts. He ran a simulation and had his computer spend 2 weeks crunching 1.5 trillion calculations in an attempt to prove his theory. As of writing, no theory has been accepted as conclusive, and the hunt for a grand unified theory of shower curtains continues. Interestingly, there is a theory that we have our best ideas while we're in the shower. So, it may be possible that the solution will come to someone mid-wash as the curtain slowly creeps in towards them. Anyway, we don't know the answer to any of these questions, but in this book, I'll be introducing you to some people who think they've more or less figured them out. Along the way, you're going to learn the word for thank you in plant language from a leading botanist. You'll be invited by conservationists to help save an endangered species from being shampooed out of existence. And you'll discover why you should probably try to avoid winning a Nobel Prize in the sciences. Most importantly, though, you'll learn that pretty much everyone in the world harbors their own little bit of batshit. I should quickly say, in this book, I will be using the term batshit a lot. I just want to let you know it's used affectionately. Just like how my dad calls me dickhead. It's said with love. Note to self, double check that. To be clear, all of my favorite people are a little bit batshit. Even the most unexpected people turn out to have odd beliefs. For example, take Nicholas Witchell, the current BBC royal correspondent, and a man who has covered virtually every major royal news story since 1998. Who would have thought this serious, plummy journalist would be a former Loch Ness monster hunter? But it turns out that for 6 months in 1972, a 19-year-old Witchell lived on the banks of Loch Ness in a self-built wooden hut, staring at the water every day with a pair of binoculars and a long-lensed camera. Nessie has been a big part of Witchell's life. It's in fact thanks to Nessie that Witchell pursued a career in journalism at all. After his 6 month stint looking for the monster, he was heading to Leeds to study law, but when an opportunity to pen a book on Nessie arose, it forced him to reconsider his future career choice. 2 years later, Witchell published his book, The Loch Ness Story, which today is still considered one of the finest books of its genre. I can understand how Witchell might have been lured into spending 6 months staring into its waters, having visited the loch myself a few years ago. When you start looking at it, you can't help but search for Nessie. It was honestly hard to tear my eyes away from the water for fear that the second I did, it might be the moment the beast surfaced. Yeah, the first decade's the hardest with that, veteran Nessie hunter Steve Feltham told me over a Zoom call recently. But you get used to it after about 10 years. Feltham, who's been living on the banks of the loch looking for the monster from his Nessie-hunting mobile home for the last 31 years, holds the Guinness World Record for the longest continuous vigil seeking the Loch Ness Monster. What's your bit of batshit? So, before we begin, let me ask you an important question. What's your bit of batshit? Do you believe in ghosts? Think you can sense when someone is staring at you from behind? Superstitious? Feel that coincidences have meaning? Have you spotted a UFO? Perhaps you're not aware of what your exact bit of batshit is. Throughout the writing of this book, I found that most people were unable to immediately identify what their weird beliefs are, largely because, to them, they're not weird beliefs, but part of their everyday reality. But don't worry, you'll realize what it is once you think about it long enough. Or maybe you know exactly what your strange belief is, but are just too afraid to say it out loud. I appreciate that too. People can be pretty unforgiving towards people who say things like, "I believe in the Mongolian death worm." That, by the way, is a mythical animal that is said to attack humans by shooting acid out of its mouth and lightning bolts out of its anus. Strange beliefs can affect your work life, your relationships, everything. In the course of writing this book, I met three people who believe they've discovered the meaning of life. Had one friend ask me in total sincerity to break character and confirm that I was an actor in his own version of The Truman Show. Drank beer with someone who claimed to be half reptilian. And listened intently as another recounted waking up early one morning to find the Virgin Mary standing at the end of their bed. That last person was my wife, Fenella. Fenella is a bit of a weirdness magnet and will feature periodically throughout this book. Unlike me, who spends countless hours rummaging through hidden bookshops, tracking down lost documentaries, and attending odd shows and conferences, the weirdnesses just seem to come directly to Fenella. For some inexplicable reason, people reveal a whole host of random odd things about their life within moments of meeting her. Just recently, we had a plumber over to fix a leak in the bathroom. After saying a quick hello, I wandered off to make him a cup of tea, leaving Fenella to show him where the problem was. A few minutes later, she joined me in the kitchen. "What an interesting guy," she said. "He was just telling me that when he was a baby in Kazakhstan, he was sitting in a field when an eagle swooped down from the sky, grabbed him by the shoulders, and flew off with him." Most would assume this story to be the ramblings of a mad plumber with an overactive imagination. But as it happens, I had met a children stolen by eagles expert a few years back, and so, instead of quickly ushering him out of my house, I got him to down tools so I could note down his story. "Fortunately," he told me, "as the bird was flapping away and struggling to gain height, my mother was able to chase after us and beat the eagle with a big stick until it dropped me back down." Fenella was 8 months pregnant with our second child when she saw the Virgin Mary at the end of our bed. To be fair, it was March 2020, and the country had just gone into its first national lockdown. Earlier that evening, before the divine visit, we sat goggle-eyed on the sofa and watched the TV as an uncharacteristically stern prime minister told us that it was now dangerous to leave the house and that pregnant women were particularly at risk. Fenella was terrified. Mary appeared not long after this. At first, Fenella was scared and thought she'd come to take our unborn child. However, after extensive Googling, she learned that Mary was actually there to tell her that everything was going to be okay. I wasn't awake to see her, but to this day, Fenella insists it happened. We inherit a lot of our weirdnesses from our family, that's for sure. Fenella comes from a religious family, and her visit from the Virgin Mary was greeted with excitement by many of them. I too have not escaped this conditioning from my own parents, and I now realize they are absolutely the reason for my interest in the wilder shores. It all really began for me at the age of 13, when following a childhood in Hong Kong, my hairdressing parents shut down their salon and relocated our family to a sleepy suburb in the northern beaches of Sydney, Australia, called Avalon. Avalon is named after the mythical resting place of King Arthur, and, when I first arrived, rocked a very New Age feel. I knew we had arrived somewhere different when, not long after we moved in, our friends Mike and Rebecca sold up and moved 60 miles inland because Rebecca had had a dream that Avalon's coast was going to be hit by a tsunami sometime soon. 2 decades later, it is yet to hit. Another time, years later, my parents got a call from our neighbor Sharon, who asked if they could pop over to help out with a tech problem she was having. She needed to unfriend someone on Facebook, but didn't know how. When my parents arrived, Sharon explained that she'd recently learned through a spiritual healer that this so-called friend of hers had actually killed her in a previous life in ancient Egypt. Just like Fenella, my parents have a gift for attracting weirdness. And I would often experience wonderful nights listening as dinner guests would drunkenly wax lyrical about esoteric matters, everything from ghosts to UFOs, before slipping me copies of books by authors like ancient alien theorist Eric von Daniken as they stumbled out the door. While this fascinating life in Avalon was instrumental in feeding my rough corner, perhaps my real leap into the world of batshit began when I started at my new high school. The Miseducation of Dan Schreiber. I was educated at a school founded...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.